But this is just the beginning. All thanks to my magic card.
This is Pot of Greed. Thanks to its straightforward effect, regular appearances in the anime, and its inclusion in starter decks for the real-life card game, it's one of the most iconic cards in the entire Yu-Gi-Oh! Franchise. For those of you who aren't familiar with what it does...
First, I'll activate my Pot of Greed card. This allows me to draw two more cards. My Pot of Greed. It lets me draw two cards.
Pot of Greed lets me draw two cards from my deck.
Next, I activate the magic card, Pot of Greed. Now I can draw two more cards.
I'll start by activating Pot of Greed. And you know what that means. I get to draw two new cards. And then...
It also happens to be one of the most horrendously overpowered and terribly designed cards ever printed. Okay, to be fair, for a cartoon where you're playing fast and loose with rules that you basically just made up, it is a good idea to have an easy way to give the characters more cards. This evil mime needs a bigger hand to power up his dragon? Pot of Greed. Want to have Kaiba use a 7-card combo to summon 5 monsters in the first turn, just to show how much of a badass he is? Pot of Greed. Need a way for the main character to have a huge comeback when it seems all is lost? You guessed it, Pot of Greed. And it's not exactly a secret that Yu-Gi-Oh! The Children's Cartoon was the biggest factor in making Yu-Gi-Oh! The Trading Card Game so popular. Even to this day, Konami is still making products specifically based on nostalgia for the old show. If there's a certain card that keeps getting used by the main characters in multiple episodes, you can bet that the fans will want to own a copy as well. The problem is, what works for a cartoon doesn't always work so well in real life, and back in the early days, nobody working on the game seemed to know what good design or good balance actually looked like. So, when it came time to add Pot of Greed into the physical game, they just copied its effect verbatim. But what is the difference between the cartoon and the actual game? Well, for the most part they work in the same way. Two players construct their own deck made of monster, spell, and trap cards, and take turns to see who can reduce their opponent's life points to zero first. The biggest difference is that in real life, there is no heart of the cards to magically help you draw the cards you need, despite what the marketing might tell you. So, unless you're cheating, your deck will have been thoroughly shuffled, and every card you draw is going to be completely random. And while other trading card games might offer players a mulligan to replace an unlucky hand, Yu-Gi-Oh! Does not. If you don't like the 5 cards you drew at the start of the game, tough luck, because you're just going to have to deal with it. Another big thing that sets Yu-Gi-Oh! Apart from most other trading card games is its resource mechanic. As in, the rules on what you have to spend in order to play a card or use an ability. Magic the Gathering has you tapping lands, Hearthstone makes you pay mana, Pokemon requires you to attach energy, and Yu-Gi-Oh! Has... nothing. Sure, each turn you only get one normal summon and one pendulum summon, and some cards might include their own costs on a case-by-case basis, but otherwise, the game makes no attempt to place a limit on how many cards you can use in a single turn. So, if your starting hand happens to contain the 5 most powerful cards in the entire game, then you can go ahead and play all of them, one after another, on your very first turn. There's nothing built into the game to stop you. This means that drawing extra cards is extremely powerful in Yu-Gi-Oh!, even more so than other trading card games. More cards doesn't just mean more options, it means immediate access to more resources, and more power over your opponent. Technically, you might win by dropping your opponent's life points to zero, but in practice, you win by having more cards than they do. So what does Pot of Greed do again? Oh yeah, draw 2 bonus cards. For free, with no drawbacks. If you're really lucky, you might even draw another Pot of Greed. Every viable strategy benefits from playing as many copies of this card as possible. There is literally no reason not to. Starting a game of Yu-Gi-Oh! With Pot of Greed in your hand is like starting a game of chess with extra pieces on your side. Okay, but what if you both max out on Pot of Greed? The extra cards for both players would cancel each other out and everyone would be happy, right? Well, yeah. If you're both lucky enough to draw it. Let's do some quick maths. So, the minimum deck size is 40 cards, and you're only allowed to put 3 copies of the same card into your deck. Punching that into a probability calculator gives us a roughly 34% chance at best for each player to start with Pot of Greed in their hand. That means there's actually a 45% chance that one player has Pot of Greed and the other doesn't. That's nearly half the time. The randomness in which cards you draw is supposed to be an obstacle that you overcome, not a mechanism for arbitrarily giving one player an advantage. All that Pot of Greed manages to do is make a lucky opening hand even more impactful, reducing the importance of actually playing the game well. Pot of Greed was undeniably bad for the health of the game, which is why it's been banned from official tournaments for over 15 years. Now, if Konami had wanted to, they could have released a new printing of Pot of Greed with a weaker effect, as they've done with other popular banned cards. But there are a couple problems with that approach. For starters, you can't change the copies that were already printed, so most of your players are still going to be using copies with the old effect written on them, which is confusing at best and an opportunity for cheating at worst. Plus, it also affects people who aren't even playing the standard competitive version of the game. There are a lot of ways to play Yu-Gi-Oh, and they all need to be balanced in different ways. But more importantly, people remember Pot of Greed because its effect is so basic. If you start adding restrictions or drawbacks onto it, you're effectively turning it into a whole new card. So, why not release the updated version as its own thing? Let's have a look at some of those new versions of Pot of Greed. Shard of Greed makes you wait 2 turns before you get to draw. It keeps the spirit of the original, but it's too slow to see any competitive use. Moray of Greed lets you draw 3 cards, but makes you put back 2 water monsters first. It's potentially very strong, but you absolutely have to be playing a ton of water monsters to go with it. Pot of Avarice adds a cost that makes you shuffle 5 monsters from your discard pile back into your deck. This was actually still a bit too strong, and it was banned until fairly recently. Cup of Ace has a 50-50 chance of backfiring and giving your opponent free cards instead. Which is quite funny, but also just really, really awful from a strategical standpoint. But still not as bad as Pot of Generosity, which makes you undraw 2 cards? There are some hits and some misses, but in my opinion, the most elegant redesign goes to Pot of Desires. First, I just want to point out this bit at the end of the card text.
You can only activate 1 Pot of Desires per turn.
Which fixes the situation where you start with more than one copy and completely steamroll your opponent. This sort of hard once per turn restriction is actually really, really common for modern Yu-Gi-Oh cards. The other, much more significant change is a new cost. In order to play Pot of Desires, you have to banish the top 10 cards of your deck face down. So, let me explain what that actually means. Okay, so normally when you're done with a card, because you finished playing it, or it died in battle, or you had to discard it for a cost or whatever, those cards end up in a discard pile, which in Yu-Gi-Oh! Is called the graveyard. But it's actually not that difficult to still make use of cards after they end up there. Revival effects are fairly common, and a lot of cards even have effects that specifically trigger in the graveyard. There are decks whose primary strategy is to send as many of their own cards to the graveyard as possible. Banishing a card face down, on the other hand, removes it from the rest of the game entirely. You can't revive it, you can't use its effects, and you can't put it back into your deck. It's just gone. Activating Pot of Desires means you're throwing away about a quarter of your entire deck, and you are never going to see those cards again. Now, it is true that you're not going to draw most of the cards in your deck in any one game of Yu-Gi-Oh, but those cards are still accessible through the magic of Searcher effects. So, reinforcement of the army adds a warrior-type monster from deck to hand. Mystic Tomato summons a dark attribute monster straight from the deck. Salamangreat Circle can add any monster whose name includes the word Salamangreat, and so on. You get the idea. Crucially, this means that you can add just a single copy of a card into your deck and still have easy access to it when you need it. Perfect for cards that only need to be used once, or that are very powerful in specific situations, or just so powerful that you're only allowed to use one copy per deck. The flexibility and consistency of searching effects like these makes them extremely popular with competitive players. And this strategy completely falls apart if the card you're searching for gets banished by Pot of Desires. If you keep just one copy of the searchable card in your deck, there's a roughly 1 in 4 chance that it's going to be banished and therefore unusable. But if you decide to add more copies of the targets to compensate, you're just making your deck less reliable by making it more likely that you draw both copies, leaving a redundant spare in your hand that you probably can't even activate because of those hard once per turn restrictions. And that's if you're even allowed to add more copies to your deck in the first place. So, what you end up with is a card that has a potentially immense payoff and a potentially devastating drawback. Maybe you draw your two best cards and banish a bunch of stuff you don't need. Maybe you draw two searcher cards but banish all the things they were supposed to be searching. High risk, high reward. All based on random chance. And that can make Pot of Desires seem terrifying, whether it's used against you or even when you use it yourself. Somehow it always seems to work out for the veteran players and never for the newbies. Weirdly enough though, that's actually kinda true. Okay, so far we've been talking about Pot of Desires from the point that you draw it during the game, but that's not really where the decision making starts. Deciding which cards go into your deck is a huge part of the game strategy, which is easy to overlook. Randomness is built into the premise of the game, and it will always be there, because every card that you draw is randomized. The goal when building a deck is to control that randomness. You can't guarantee that you'll draw the perfect hand, so you include as many different ways of getting to the outcome you want as possible. If plan A falls through, you go to plan B, or plan C, or D, or E. It might make that theoretical perfect hand a bit weaker, but it makes the bad hand so much stronger. And when competitive tournaments can go for over 15 rounds, consistency is king. Take a look at this clip from the 2019 World Championship Final. For context, both players are using a Salamangreat deck that relies on this card, Salamangreat Gazelle. It's not that important what it does, but it's absolutely essential for executing the deck's main combos, and for this event it's been limited to just one copy per deck. Koki Kosaka is going first, and his opening hand is terrible. It's a bunch of disruption cards that do literally nothing until his opponent's turn. The only thing he can do is activate Pot of Desires.
Not what you want to see, so this Pot of Desire will be the deciding factor for this game. He really needs to pick up some of the engine cards, and luckily for him, Chai did not open a single Entrap, so...
Let's see where Kosaka is going. It's off these top two cards.
Now the next step is slowly check those 10 banished cards for a Gazelle. It's the first card. Wow.
Oh, it's so dangerous running Pot of Desires when you only have one copy of your key card.
So, Kosaka's best card is banished, and he has to end his turn with nothing to defend himself. But it's not quite as bad as it seems. See, despite being by far the most popular strategy at the time, Salamangreat decks actually struggle to do enough damage to win in just one turn. And if everybody's playing the same type of deck as you, there's a pretty good chance that your opponent is playing the exact cards that you need. Kosaka knows that, so his plan B is to use a bunch of cards which let him outright steal his opponent's most powerful monsters. He goes on to win this game. And that is how you mitigate Pot of Desires' cost. Trade power for versatility, and always have a backup plan. Banishing the Gazelle was unlucky, but thanks to some careful planning, Kosaka's strategy was versatile enough to just about deal with it. A master duelist is someone who can build a versatile, reliable deck, and who knows precisely what any given hand is capable of. So yeah, Pot of Desires does work out better for the veteran players, because they basically fixed the problem before the game even started. Pot of Greed is well known because of its simple effect, and ultimately, that's what got it banned. But just by adding one deceptively subtle cost, it was reborn as Pot of Desires, a card which places interesting and engaging restrictions on deck building, rewards adaptable players who can create multiple paths to victory, and still manages to generate nostalgia for the goofy cartoon that brought everybody here in the first place. One of the most well-designed and well-balanced cards in the history of Yu-Gi-Oh! A worthy successor to Pot of Greed. So, while I was writing this, they announced an even worse version of Pot of Generosity. Or maybe putting back only one card is better? Who knows?
And I'm not done drawing cards yet, Typhon. Now, I activate Pot of Desires. I banish the top 10 cards of my deck face down to draw two cards.
You'll need all the cards you can get.